All right, folks, welcome back to Rugby Ascendant. This is Chris here in central Pennsylvania. And my guest this time around is Johan Mommsen from South Africa. Johan, hoegaandit, hoeiedag.
Goedanke, lekker.
Excellent. He's doing well. So, of course, he's from the Western Province part of South Africa there. Now, Johan, unlike all of our North American guys who play rugby, you didn't wait so long to start. I mean, Matt Heaton didn't start till about 14 years of age. Lost a little bit of development there. As I understand it, your dad was a coach, and you got kind of bold there at the age of six, picked up a ball and never stopped.
Yeah, I would say even earlier than that, my dad was coaching our school's first team. So I probably grew up from the age of three, just hanging around him, kicking balls with the likes of guys like Scott Berger, DeVette Barry, big Springboks. So that was a big deal for me growing up, playing on the same field as them. So I had big aspirations from a little boy. And I wouldn't say my dad ever pressured me into playing rugby. I think it was just one of the things that came with seeing everything he does.
Well, you played for Western Province and the under 19, under 21s back in 2014, 2015. What was that like? I mean, that's an iconic and interest of full disclosure. I do this with all my interviews. I'm a Province fan. I have been for over 30 years. I mean, why not? They've won more Currie Cups than everybody else. And why not? But I'm a big Province fan. All the big names have played there for the most part. What was that like putting on the hoops?
Brilliant. I was lucky enough to do it at school too, final year of school. So under 18, 19 and 21. And that 3 years of rugby was probably that laid the foundations for me playing professionally. Learned a lot, great systems, playing under 18, 19 and 21 for the province. You get in touch with Springboks, like you said, guys like Ibn Etzebet, you see walking around the same building as you. Scott Berger, you see a few times. I mean, it's just seeing them in on the same field as you train in, it makes you aspire more, I think. Gives you more reason to work harder. So that was very special for me, playing in the hoops as that was the city and the region I grew up in. And then, I had to move on, unfortunately.
Well, you're from that area. You're from Paarl originally, yes?
Yes.
Yeah, and you also played at Stellenbosch for a few years.
I played at Stellenbosch University after under 21. Decided to finish my studies first. Took me about 4 years, I think. Played for University of Stellenbosch in the Varsity Cup. And, that was also part of the foundation that was laid for me to get into the professional setup. Enjoyed that a lot. The Varsity Cup is something very special.
Oh, it is. It's ironic because I tell people that don't know rugby in South Africa, it's now we have to take this year and last year out of the mix because it's not real when it comes to rugby. But let's go back to 2019 and let's say the decade prior. For me, watching Currie Cup games on television is very sad. Not the play, but the stands. There's almost nobody there. It's pathetic. But if you watch a varsity game and South Africa, thousands of people still come to those games. It's unbelievable. The atmosphere at varsity level in South Africa oftentimes is much more electric and engaging than what you see in Currie Cup these days.
Yeah, I think you can almost compare it smaller scale, but you can compare it to college football and NFL, I guess. I think it's just more exciting seeing the young youth, the people coming through. You're going to see what the future looks like. And also the Varsity Cup has a few rule twists where they try to speed up the game. And I think the youth just makes it very exciting.
Now, you were also Western Province's Club Player of the Year one season as well. Congratulations on that. That's quite an honor.
Thanks.
That's quite an honor.
Yeah, it was special.
Now, I may be a Province fan, but I have a soft spot for the people that for some bizarre reason like to play their rugby on a concrete pitch. Of course, that's the Greek was. for those who don't know what I'm talking about, it's not concrete, but I'm sure Johan can tell us when you hit the ground, it sure feels like concrete up there. What was it like playing for the Greek was? You got 18 appearances, if I'm not mistaken, with the Greek was in Currie Cup.
Yeah. Also, like I said, it's special playing there. Greek was the second oldest union in South Africa, just off the province, Western Province. So I feel like it's also something that had to happen for me to develop as a player. I am the mindset going to Greek was, like you said, you play on a hard pitch. People don't like coming there. So, you
they
know,
don't.
Yep.
They
I mean,
don't.
It's a lower budget team. So, I mean, it's one of the teams where if you take the pitch, you just have to play as hard as your pitch is. The other team has to feel that. I mean, it's just how the identity there. So it learned a lot. Had to learn to tackle harder there. Had to learn to run harder. So it's just all part of it. I still enjoyed it a lot. Yeah.
Well, you're right about that second oldest union there, a team in South Africa. But what's also interesting is that while other teams in Currie Cup and in Super Rugby are named after animals and colors, like New Zealand, the Blues and Reds. Come on, I'm sorry, I can't buy into that. But you know, in South Africa, you got the Sharks and you got the Bulls and such. The Greek was actually it's an iconic name. It's named after a group of mixed race colored South Africans who migrated to that region. The Greek was under Adam Cook, and a lot of people don't know the heritage. That's got to be an interesting aspect of it too. That it's not just simply named after some wildlife, but actually a group of people.
Yeah, it is. It's special. And I don't think it's it gets even playing there, it gets told a lot, because the Griqua badge is actually the oryx, which is also an antelope in that area, a big one. So I mean, that's what we go by normally, usually. I think that's as the badge shows. But it is cool knowing that it's a whole different diversity reason that we play for the Griquas. It's all that it's called the Griquas.
Well, I have to say that one thing, now I'm kind of glad that we've had a chance to chat one-on-one here, because I don't know anybody with the Griqua organization, and getting their jerseys online is kind of hard to do. And I haven't been to Kimberley in a long time. It's kind of out of the way, if you know what I mean. I've driven through Kimberley and around it to get to Bloemfontein for the Tri-Nations. So if we could talk offline, if you can put me in contact with somebody, get me a Griquas jersey. Those Griquas jerseys, that teal color jersey, is one of the most awesome rugby jerseys out there. Yeah. So,
yeah. Yeah. Very special.
But you're right about teams don't want to go up there and play. I mean, a lot of teams that are top of the log expect to do really well. They struggle sometimes up there playing against the Greek was on that pitch, because it's like, who wants to play concrete?
Yeah, the pitch is definitely a leveler. If you talk about a away game going to Kimberley, it's definitely not the same as going to another nice pitch and just going and play another away game, because it's not only the fans that intimidate you, the grass and the team that come up against you, a bunch of hard guys that just really comes at you, is very intimidating up in Kimberley. So I think a special place to play rugby at.
Well, I think we have to, in interest full disclosure, let people know the truth there. Johan says the grass, but that's just a fairy tale. It's not grass. They just paint the dirt.
Yeah. In the wintertime, the grass all dead.
Exactly. They just paint the dirt up there in Kimberley. But so you've lived in some interesting locations. I mean, so you're from the Western Cape, one of the most iconic and beautiful spots in the world, with a Mediterranean climate. Paarl is nestled right there against the mountains. You've got Franschhoek nearby. You've got Stellenbosch in Cape Town. Quite a beautiful spot. Of course, for those that don't know, it's the heart of the Afrikaans language, the Taal Monument, the language monument, the only language in the world that monument's right there in Paarl. It's a beautiful spot. You've played there, then you've went up to Kimberley, which is kind of sparse and destitute from a vegetation standpoint. Yeah. And now you're in Atlanta, which is quite green, but viciously humid in the summertime. It's like Durban without the beaches. So what's it like living in these different places? Has it been a big change for you, adjusting physically to those different environments?
It's awesome. I think it's definitely a big adjustment, the humidity for me. The heat, not so much. I mean, we're used to the same type of temperatures, high temperatures, maybe even a little higher, but this humidity is really it just gets still getting worse every day. So it's different training with a very sweaty jersey. You're gonna be wet all the time, really focus hard catching the ball. I mean, back home in South Africa, if we know it's going to rain or we're going to Durban this weekend, we'll train with a ball that's wet with some soap on it, even maybe training with a slippery ball. We never have to do that here. We have the slipperiness. So actually, again, I think good for development, learning all different conditions and different places. Also, the turf pitches we have here, barely have any grass in the east, in the Eastern Conference. So it's also adjustment, but everything that contributes to more experience, I guess. It's exciting.
No doubt about it. That's definitely the case. But Curry Cup, comparing to Major League Rugby, it's still a new league. And of course, we got a lot of big names have come. You guys played against some of this weekend. You had DTH Vandermeer from Canada there. And of course, Adam Ashley Cooper, Matt Guido. You've played against some big names, Ben Foden against Rooney, place like that. So a lot of internationals have come over and joined. Of course, you're an international. You're from South Africa. But a lot of big names, a lot of established names have come at Major League Rugby. It's got to make for an interesting mix. I mean, for a new league, it's one would assume maybe it's better than we expected, but maybe it's still not up to the level we see in the Pro 14 or Super Rugby or Curry Cup even. What's it like? I mean, how do you feel about the level of competition in Major League Rugby?
From the 5 games last year to the bunch of games we've played this year, way, way, way higher. I mean, I feel like every game is getting better. I don't think I've ever played on statistics bowling play as much as we played this past weekend against the Giltinis. There was another game 2 or 3 weeks back that the bowling play was also, I think, 38 and a half minutes. This weekend was 42 minutes, which is, I think, higher than an average Super Rugby game. So it's the level is definitely getting up there. It's probably not there yet. I think a little bit more errors. And if you make an error, you won't get punished as hard. I think that is the only thing that I can pick up. But if I think I'm enjoying rugby even more than I think back home. It's exciting. Everything's new. There's way more things going on around the rugby, which I think America is very good at doing. Sports and the marketing side of it is next level. So, enjoying everything. And I think is big things to come.
Definitely. That's certainly a draw for America. And one reason why when Super Rugby was talking about expanding and they looked at Japan and Argentina, I'm like, well, you might consider Hawaii or the West Coast if you're going to do that, because one thing about the U.S. is the television markets, the marketing, the spectacle they make of all sport. I mean, they could turn bowling into a huge bonanza, yeah. Which is, you know, it's what, yeah. So I agree with you on that. That's pretty interesting. And it just dawned on me, you know, I suppose playing with the Greek was great preparation for playing on artificial turf. I mean, you're used to hitting the ground pretty hard with concrete under it.
Yeah, definitely. I think even the turf is even a little softer than our pitch in Kimberley, but I think I might get a little bit more turf burn, but that's nothing our doctor can't sort out, so it's all good.
Well, I'm going to put you on the spot now, because Rugby ATL puts this up on your bio for your site, and it talks about your time at Stellenbosch and says that you were an avid scholar. Now, I'm going to hope that's a true statement, and if it is, do you have a favorite subject that interested you?
My favorite subject since school has been mathematics. I love maths. Everything I studied was in the line of mathematics, so it was exciting. I got my degree in financial and investment management. I tried 1 year of engineering, but doing that with rugby didn't work out too well, so went to the financial part. Enjoyed that a lot with financial accounting and mathematics. It played into my interests. So, yeah, it was fun.
So maths, that's a bit of a surprise. I wasn't expecting that. For some reason, I thought maybe engineering, but maths, okay. I'm going to guess here, for those who don't know South African context, won't get this, but I'm going to guess that you probably did a little bit better than 30 or 40% on your matrix score to get into university.
Yeah, I'm not too sure how the matrix stuff works, but if you go on the normal system, I think good A+, man, most of the subjects. I was happy with that. My mom was happy, so I think if she was happy, at least all good. I mean, my mom's a teacher, so if she was happy about it, it's all good.
Excellent. So now a couple of last notes here is that I understand that you enjoy golf. Did you play in South Africa, or is it something you picked up in the US?
No, we played it all casually, but started in high school. I think when I was 15, my dad bought me a set of clubs, and after school, I bought myself a little bit of an upgraded set, and just in our off time, you know, rugby players love doing something that just gets you ahead of the game. So that's what we in South Africa and Kimberley, that's what we get up to in most of our off time. And I think we try to do it here every now and then if the body's not hurting too much, get out and play a quick 9 or something. So yeah, enjoy golf a lot.
Well, South Africa is well known for a long, long history, and even a recent history of really quality top locks. I mean, some great names in the game, Victor Matfield, Evan Etzebeth, Lou Diager, some big names. And I guess we can add Johan Mommsen to that list of iconic locks.
Easy now. Easy. Thanks, though.
Well, and one final note, another thing is I understand you're into video games. Is that true?
Yeah, I do. I do. I've got an Xbox. I play some Xbox, FIFA especially. I like the soccer. And
No. Stop. Stop. That's not a real, it's not a real sport. I'm sorry.
Just on the console.
Oh, on the console. Okay, gotcha. Well, Johan, it looks like you're enjoying your time there. You've been with Atlanta since 2019, and you seem to be doing quite well. This. Let me ask you one thing about this game this past weekend. This was titanic. Now, I was in Jersey City to watch LA play Rooney, and that was their first loss. And Rooney found a way to shut their try scoring machine down, and they managed to beat them just on penalty conversions, 18-16. You guys scored tries against LA, who has a tough defense of their own, but you really held them in check. They did get a couple of tries that I think Coach Lawrence may have been a little disappointed that those happened, but still, I mean, you guys were amazing. What's it like in that defense? I mean, I was on the sidelines at this game, and I was just waiting for stretchers to come out. Eventually, a stretcher did come out, unfortunately, for one of the Giltinis. But I mean, the bone-crushing hits were just – you could hear those things, you know, on the other side of the pitch. It was – it had to be tough. How are you feeling this week? You a little sore? You good?
It was definitely a little sore. Till yesterday, we got some treatment. Yesterday, off day, so it was good. This morning felt fresh. So, I think we've been managed well going into this weekend, pretty fresh again. So, on the field, I think I haven't been in a spot where you feel so comfortable on defense. You know everyone's going to make the tackle. You know standing out wide, the guys tackling the big guys up front is just going to take them back. If it's you, you just accept you're that guy doing it. And I think everyone has taken the responsibility on themselves of being that guy to make the tackle. So it's no one on the field has all the responsibility on their shoulders. So I think everyone is pretty comfortable in the team if we get into a big defensive set. And I think it shows.
Well, that was really awesome performance. I mean, it's just, I've seen some amazing games this year. That one was, and it went right down to the end. I mean, if you guys had broken, they would have won. I mean, all they needed was a converted try and they could have won the game. So they got within like 8 meters of that try line. And then Mark O'Keefe, intercepted a ball and then it was turned back and forth. You finally got the counter ruck and the game was over. It seemed to be a great deal of joy and elation after that amongst the players on the pitch over a hard fought win. So congratulations on that victory. And five, you're welcome. Five consecutive ones. It's just, it's pretty awesome. You go off to NOLA this weekend and then it's on to Rooney. As I told Matt Heaton, it's no rest for the wicked. Five wins. Can you catch a break? No, you got NOLA and Rooney back to back.
Yeah.
Well, Johan, bye donkey for your time today. I really appreciate it. It's a pleasure chatting with you and good luck this weekend, the rest of the season. And we'll get back with you hopefully in another conversation sometime soon.
Thank you, Chris. See you again.
Cheers.